Audio test, 1, 2.
Good evening.
Good evening. My name is Nathan Ziegler, and I am the upper school principal here at Hamburg Academy. Because this is such an important event, I thought it would be helpful to share some of our expectations for tonight's ceremony. At this time, masks are still required in schools, and so we would ask that you please wear your mask while in the building. Graduates will remove their masks while they receive their diplomas, and then when we go outside for the reception, you feel free to take those off. We would like this event to be one that is marked with reverence toward God, thankfulness, respect, honor, and celebration. Because of this, we ask that you do not leave your seats to go into the aisles to take pictures. Out of respect for the guests around you, we ask that if you're going to take pictures, you remain seated in order not to disrupt the ceremony. There will be someone who will be taking photographs with a professional camera during the event, which will be made available for download at no cost on the Hope Academy's website. Please also feel free to return to the stage after graduation and take pictures of the graduates. Thanks for respecting this request. One more note, a very, very warm reception will follow in the courtyard. So you'll just go down the stairs and up to the courtyard if you'd like. And you're all invited to attend that. And if you parked in the ramp and did not receive a ramp ticket when you came into the building, those will also be available outside of the reception. If you have small children and plan to stay for the reception in the courtyard, after the ceremony, please make sure that they're being respectful to all the hard work that's been done to beautify the courtyard with the flowers and the plants. Thank you for respecting these requests. We will be enjoying them.
Thank you.
Thank you. Good afternoon, everyone. This time, I'd like to ask your attention so we can do the invocation. Let's bow our heads, please. Heavenly Father, please be with us on this momentous occasion as we honor this graduating class on this glorious day. There have been many challenges over the years, and especially this last school year with the virus and distance learning. We give you thanks that the senior class has overcome all the challenges and accomplished all they need to do to participate in this event that they will remember for the rest of their lives. God, we thank you for the teachers and the staff who shared their wisdom and poured knowledge into the students. We thank you for the parents and friends and relatives who supported the students in many different ways. And God, most of all, we thank you for bringing us together this day to celebrate all that you have done in these students' lives. As these students leave Home Academy and move forward with the next chapter of their lives, we pray that you would continue to bless them and watch over them. May they have many more successes in the future. To God be the glory for the things he has done. Amen, amen, amen.
Good evening. My name is Dan Olson, and on behalf of the faculty, staff, leadership, and board of directors of Home Academy, I want to welcome you, parents, family, friends, to our school. It's our 10th graduation ceremony. You 21 graduates here join nearly 150 others who have gone out into the world marked by this school. For the rest of your life, Home Academy will be one of your alma maters. The words alma mater are Latin, and they literally mean soul mother. At our biological birth, each of us is formed in our mother's womb, and God marks us with the DNA of our biological parents. In the same way, our souls, our spiritual DNA, are marked for good or bad by the schools we attend. 25 years ago, I was sitting in the same place that you are, and I graduated from a local Christian high school, like you are. And each passing year, I appreciate more and more the mark that that school left on my soul. The mission of Hope Academy, as you probably know, is to foster hope in God by providing you and others with a remarkable God-centered education. Your souls have been indelibly marked by this mission. Tonight, we're here to celebrate you, your completion of high school, and the mark of God in your lives. Our prayer tonight is that your soul has been marked for good and marked for life, and that you will go with God from this day forth. So welcome. It's wonderful to have you here.
Greetings, fellow graduates, faculty, family of graduates, and distinguished guests. It is my honor to speak in front of all of you today. When Ms. Kasser-Kalu informed me that I had been selected to share my testimony concerning what God has done for me during my time at home, I was nothing short of panicked. I was not sure what I was going to say before all of you today. I know that I have grown as a person in many areas during these last 13 years, but I feel that there is still so much for me to do before earning the right to come up here. However, after having a much-needed conversation with Mr. Troy, I came to the realization that this did not have to be a proclamation of my spiritual accomplishments. I only need to share the things that God has done for me during my time here. I would not consider myself to fit the stereotype of the radical Christian. I am not the first one to arrive to church services. I am not the loudest worshiper, nor the one that rushes to the front of the congregation when the opportunity presents itself. I do attend the services faithfully, but I tend to glance up at the clock more often than I should. I am also not a very emotional person. I do not feel the presence of God in the same way that others around me do. I am not overcome by waves of strong emotions that engulf me in God. and so that I must make a strong conscious effort to even begin to experience or feel God's presence. I'm not saying that I'm not a Christian. In fact, I'm trying to communicate quite the opposite. I have been doing and still believe in God's existence. And while I'm still definitely a work in progress, I can confidently say that I have faith in God. I have identified as a Christian for as long as I can remember. Having been born and raised in a Christian community, assuming my parents' beliefs felt like the right thing to do. And while initially I accepted it as a default setting, eventually a true understanding of what I claimed to be began to appear. This, however, did not happen until around the time I was entering high school. As my belief grew, I began to evaluate and review the level and quality of my faith. I often found myself comparing my faith to my parents' faith, and I saw how deep their love for God ran, and how comparatively shallow my love was. I struggled with what religion meant to me and how it fit into my life. I saw myself surrounded by adults who had a desire to be with God, and when I reflected on myself, I felt that I was at a spiritual standstill. I wanted to know where this passion was coming from and how I could get it. I remember my sophomore year, I thought I had it figured out. I went to New Orleans on a missions trip with my classmates, and while we were there, we met an eccentric but very kind elderly woman who promised she could teach us to speak in tongues. I was intrigued, and seemingly so were many of my peers, because a handful of us spent an hour in a room with her attempting to speak in tongues. It was also about an hour later that I concluded that I could not speak in tongues. In the time following the events of the mission trip, I would continue to grow in my faith. However, it wasn't until I let my guard down and just talked about what I was thinking that I really began to make some progress. I came to realize that the people you surround yourself with, the people whose opinions you allow to influence you, and the general environments that you occupy are some of the factors that affect your spiritual growth the most. This wasn't an instantaneous realization. Many of the words that I am speaking right now were first articulated in the process of writing this speech. However, once this thought was ingrained into my mind, I realized how grateful I should be. God has made it possible for me to learn in the school that encouraged religious growth. He has put people in my life that reminded me of the importance of faith, and he has challenged me to continue to pursue it. Even so, I know there are still many flaws in my connection to God. I am fully aware that I am years of dedication away from beginning to experience what God wants me to experience. I recognize now that I am embarking on a journey not just in life, but also in faith. In fact, we all are. And as we prepare to leave behind the hallways of Hope Academy, I want to challenge my class and any members of the audience to not forget about God, but to continue to seek after Him, even if it is difficult and it's an ongoing journey. Seek out people who know God, who will positively influence your faith. Do this knowing that faith in the one who loves and forgives us is the foundation of our joy. Thank you.
Friends, family, teachers, and fellow students, as I stand before you today, I have realized there are two options that lie open before me. I could stand up and tell you for the 100th time how we are living in unprecedented and challenging times, or I can tell you a story. I'm making the executive decision to be the latter rather than be the dead horse. My classmates who have been with me since middle school have known me to be someone desperate for the approval of other people. From staying up until 2 a.m. constructing unnecessarily extravagant science posters in order to win the praise of our beloved teachers, to directly handing my homework to classmates when they would ask. Yes, I will get all our diplomas revoked. I was desperate to be loved by all, but I received an epiphany one day in Mr. Kite's 6th grade Bible class. Mr. Kite, noticing the uncanny similarity in our class assignments, confronted the class about cheating. He had uncovered the underground operation of Alea Wellman, 12, dealer of illegal answers, enabler of bad habits, queen of lies. Like a criminal, the chief of sinners, I turned myself in. I realized that in my pursuit of being liked, I lost sight of one of the most valuable yet undervalued virtues of this age, integrity. Although I arguably had good intentions, in my pursuit to be loved, I compromised the truth. I exchanged integrity for a lie. Integrity is not merely doing the right thing when no one is watching, but rather seeking truth and living truly. But we live in a world of lies, a world that makes us cynical of everything. We are left in the place of Pontius Pilate, asking the same crucial question, what is truth? When the bullets of political propaganda never cease to penetrate our minds, when everywhere we turn, we are being force-fed an agenda, an opinion, or a demand, mining truth, let alone living truly, is utterly exhausting. Social media only douses gasoline on smoldering embers. I think we all know a single Twitter comment ignites a forest fire. We are fish in poisoned water. The total rejection of absolute truth is killing us, and we are oblivious. Everything, including science and history itself, is politicized, twisted, and manipulated to support a narrative. Even if truth is manipulated with good intentions, we sell ourselves into one disastrous bargain. When history is compromised, we silence the dead. When science is politicized, we reject reason and settle for ignorance. And when morality itself is undefined, we are left with an entire generation of lost and purposeless people. When we throw out the entire idea of objective truth in the name of tolerance, we trade diamonds for lead. We may believe we are doing the right thing, as I believed when I was helping my classmates, when in reality, we are selling ourselves and the world short. Manipulation only mars truth, because truth is strong enough to stand alone for those who are willing to seek it. So, the task awaits us. Amidst the web of lies, we must take up the fight for truth. Class of 2021, if anyone is equipped for this fight, it is us. In a time when political, ethnic, and ideological divisions are tearing our communities apart, our time at Hope has taught us the truth. Friendship and genuine love transcend barriers. We will never forget the memories we've made together. We journeyed 13 hours in two cramped white minivans, sheet rain pouring down and tornado warnings ringing in our ears, only to dig, organize, wash, and weed the community in Memphis, Tennessee. In an age of spiritual and social chaos, we have studied the major historical movements from the events of Tiananmen Square to the Civil Rights Movement that awaken us from complacency and inspire us to challenge the status quo. We have learned the values that are essential to righteously fighting for justice: human dignity, sacrificial love, and forgiveness. In an age when writing, rhetoric, ethics, and philosophy are all but lost, we have grappled with major ethical systems, constructed and defended our senior theses, and memorized and eloquently presented CE Night pieces. We have dried each other's tears, desperately begged the teachers for extensions, and laughed at everything from Mr. Z wearing a durag on the 10th grade mission trip to Mr. Choi constantly begging us not to snack during class. We have climbed the mountains and journeyed the valleys in pursuit of one thing, truth. We did not make this climb alone. We learned to love, but only because we were taught. We learned to serve, but only because we were gifted. Through his entertaining class stories, constant demonstrations of self-sacrifice, and simple acts of fatherly kindness, such as driving students to school or counseling classmates who are having a rough day, Mr. Hoba has demonstrated genuine love. Mr. H is not alone, as the dozens of humble teachers at Hope daily sacrifice their lives with one goal: revealing to students the character of Christ. They teach us that only love, vulnerability, and integrity provide us with a shield against deception and chaos. Class of 2021, I implore you, never stop seeking the truth. In this age, it is all we have. Even as we close this chapter and go our separate ways, we have a singular task: to be people of integrity. Every day, regardless of your vocation, location, income, regardless of your gender, social status, success, or failure, you will always have this one task in front of you. Be diligent, steadfast, and honest. Be vulnerable, and don't fear failure. But above all, love. For rightly ordered loves is essential to being a person of integrity. Seek the truth, be true. Remember that when we walk in pursuit of truth, we are moving toward a person who, in an ultimate act of integrity, out of sacrificial love and in obedience to the Father, died for those who hated him, to reveal the nature of truth to us. May we go transformed by the truth of the gospel. Thank you.
Somber crowd you are. Is this how y'all are in church service?
No.
No? Y'all, well, okay. I'm going to sing a song for y'all today, and this is directly to the seniors. I hope that you all remember that as you move forward in your next couple of years, some of you have decided to go into a trade, same thing I did, and some of you have decided to go on to extend your education with a degree. Remember, as you continue in life, there's always going to be struggles. But we know, as Israel said, he's challenged you to remember who God is in your life. Even though a lamb won't be there to pass you the answers, she won't be there to tell you which scripture to go to when you're going through something. Just remember, as the teachers that have filled the halls with love and with prayer for you all, you know how to get to Christ. Don't forget that if you're looking for an answer, go to God. Amen? All right.
Because of you, but my days were cold this winter.
friends, family, and staff, and most importantly, graduating seniors. Tonight, my address, I am going to be able to hold it together. That's what's going to happen right here. Hold it together. My words of encouragement and my challenge is going to be to you, the senior class. As I've said once before, we're going to extend the walls of our classroom to include all of those who are in our midst. I'm going to pretend like they're not here and it's just you. So I may make a few references to things that the rest of the audience is not familiar with. It's okay. Sorry, it's my joke. I'm going to begin with a familiar passage. It's from 2 Timothy. This is from the Apostle Paul, and he's speaking to a young Timothy. And when I read it, I want you to hear the challenge. I charge you, Paul says, in the presence of God and of Christ Jesus, who is to judge the living and the dead, and by his appearing in his kingdom, preach the word, be ready in season and out of season, reprove, rebuke, and exhort with complete patience and teaching. For the time is coming when people will not endure sound teaching, but having itching ears, do this. But having itching ears, they will accumulate for themselves teachers to suit their own passions, and will turn away from listening to the truth, and will wander off in myths. As for you, always be sober-minded, endure suffering, do the work of an evangelist, fulfill your ministry, for I am already being poured out as a drink offering, and the time of my departure has come. I have fought the good fight, I have finished the race, I have kept the faith. Henceforth, there is laid up for me the crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will award to me on that day. Not only to me, but also to all who have longed or loved his appearing. Did you catch the challenge? The challenge there is, I am finishing well, will you? 25 years ago, I received a gift in the form of a challenge. And I've never shared this in this format with you, but you've heard all of this in some way, shape, or form through the years, through your high school. And I heard an address by a professor of leadership at a seminary in Southern California. His name is Robert Clinton. And he did an address at a leadership summit in Estes Park, Colorado in 1994, entitled Finishing Well, The Challenge of a Lifetime. And what I'm giving you tonight are mostly his words, but they've been hurlbuttized. Okay? And I have my own examples, okay, because I've got a few years under my belt, and as you know, I've done lots of stupid things. And fortunately, God's grace is present in our lives, and that our stupid things are not the final story. They're not the final story. And actually, it's an opportunity for God's redemptive power. So let's begin by defining terms. This is how Dr. Clinton and his co-author defines finishing well. To finish well does not mean to reach perfection, but rather to keep on pressing toward it, still growing in your love for Christ and intimacy with him, still pressing on to make him known, still living as his disciple, and loving the people God places in your life, relentlessly seeking to know and do God's will, fulfilling your God-given potential. Now my question for you is, who wouldn't want that? Think about that. When the day comes when we see Christ, we are going to be overcome with not a feeling, although there are feelings attached. We are going to be overcome by an awareness of the fact that every decision that we made, every step that we made, every word that we spoke mattered. It happened during a point in time when the things we did, the things we said, attitudes, spoken and unspoken, would matter for all of eternity. All. And we have a short life, relatively, to do it all. And what that means is that every moment indeed counts. It has eternal consequences. And something that Dr. Clinton did was that he recognized, he was listening to the New Testament speak. And the New Testament says this, this is a passage from 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 6. Now these things, and these things here talks about some sinners in the Old Testament. Now these things took place as examples for us that we might not desire evil as they did. And then this is a passage from Romans chapter 15. And for whatever was written in former days was written for our instruction, that through endurance and through the encouragement of the scriptures, we might have hope. And so Dr. Clinton and his team recognized that things are written in scripture to be examples for us. And as you've heard me say before, I would much rather learn from other people's mistakes rather than my own. Life is too short. And we can look in scripture, and we can learn from the examples of those who have gone before us. And so Dr. Clinton and his team studied scripture, and they looked at all of the leaders in scripture, and they ended up putting them all in categories. And there are categories of finishes that are shooting up on the screen here, that he put the 1,000 leaders that are mentioned in the Bible into. Cut off early. And this would be, for example, Josiah, King Josiah, would also include John the Baptist, James the disciple. And these are those that died in battle or were martyred. And so they were cut off early. And so it's in their scheme of things, they put them into that category. Finished poorly. These are people that may have started well, but then they finished poorly. Consider King Saul. He had everything that it took to be a great king. Could I get some water? So there's a category of those who finished poorly. There's also those who finished so-so. King David fits into this category. King David was indeed a man after God's own heart. He was a man who knew how to repent. These are his strengths. But King David actually finished so-so. Significant consequences because of his poor choices, both in his family and within the kingdom. And as you know, when I hear somebody say, I wouldn't have changed a thing, it was all meant to be, I'm not so sure about that. King David, when you read the Psalms, didn't adhere to that super strongly. King David had regret, and if he could do things over again, he would have done some things differently. And my encouragement to you is that you would do likewise. Finish well. This is a short list, ladies and gentlemen. It's a short list. At the beginning of Dr. Clinton's address, he said, most Christian leaders don't finish well. Let that sink in. I'm not a math guy, but I know that most means like more than 50%. And according to his definition of finishing well, more than half don't. And so this, ladies and gentlemen, is a short list. And then there's a category which includes people like Paul and Christ. Of course, Jesus is the ultimate finisher, the ultimate person who finishes well in Scripture. So they looked at the Bible first, and there's, as I said, about 1,000 leaders that are mentioned by name in the Bible. And of those 1,000, there's about 100 where we have. There's about 100 where we have a little bit more than a name or a title. Of those 100, there's about 50, 49 to be exact, where Clinton and his team of doctoral students determined that they could determine how well they finished. Of those 49, we have 13 in the whole Bible that they deem as those who finished well. So that's right about 25%. Okay, that should get our attention. There's a pretty good chance that if we're just moving along with the flow, there's a reasonable chance that we may not be within that category. Okay? And so Dr. Clinton did this. This is what has been such an incredible gift to me over the years. They went through and they studied these people. They did this for people within the church as well. So in the church age, after the Bible was written, the Church of Christ was established, they studied those leaders as well, and they found that those numbers were about the same as the biblical numbers, about 25%. And so what they did was is that they determined and identified six barriers to finishing well, and then also five things to enhance good finishes. So these are things to avoid and things to build into our lives to help us be those that on that day, on that day, when we're in front of Him, and we've lived it, it's all done. On that day, He says, Adrian, well done. He says, Theodore, well done. Logan, well done. Sophia, and Proverbs tells us that the wise man sees what's coming from afar and makes adjustments. This is the rollback paraphrase. Makes adjustments, notices, and says, I'm not going to be sideswiped by that because Jesus means more to me than that. My life means more to me than that. And so the wise man is one that makes adjustments and is not taken out by the obstacles. See it coming. The wise man notices, takes precautions. So here's the words for you this day. And my prayer is, you know, even if you took a picture of my notes, you know, it disappears somewhere. All right? But this is what I believe, and this is my prayer, that the living God of the universe would find with seeds good soil in your hearts, and would plant these seeds such that they would grow and would bear fruit in Jesus' name. So we're going to talk about six barriers to finishing well very, very briefly, and then enhancers to good finishes. Six barriers to finishing well, they're listed up on the screen for you. Money, sex, and power, okay, are the top three. We've got pride, family, and plateauing to round out the top six, okay? Money, we can talk a lot about money. What do you dream about? You want to know what you really worship? Look at your bank statement. That's the best indicator. Okay, look out. Who do you love and what do you love? Look at your calendar. Okay, so how do you spend your money? How do you spend your time? I would encourage you to do this. It's really, really easy to be greedy. Greed is an equal opportunity employer. Goes after people with lots of money and people with no money. All right, greed is like a little green monster that sits on our shoulder, a good friend of mine used to say. And it whispers stuff to us. And it wounds us. It speaks lies to us that sound really compelling because, dang, those wealthy people look like they got it all together. And we want more and more and more. So I want to tell you this, to learn to respond to the opposite in the opposite spirit. When you hear covetousness, when you hear coveting tempting you, when you hear greed calling out to you. And the opposite spirit says this, when the little green monster whispers in your ear as the offering plate goes by, you really can't afford to put $5 in there. That the only way to deal with that little green monster is aggressive. You say, if you don't shut up, I'll give it to him. Be quiet. When we're concerned and feeling like we don't have enough, find the nicest thing in your closet. That you love. and give it to somebody who has less than you. Consider that. Break the back of those voices with generosity. Break the back of those voices with generosity. Sex, I don't mean to say much, this might surprise you, but people fall into sexual sin and it absolutely destroys people. Destroys people. And the best way to deal with it, the better off you will be. I like to follow the example of Joseph. When he was tempted by Potiphar's wife, he ran like H-E-double-hockey-sticks. That's what he did. And we would do well. The first time that I saw a hint of something inappropriate on my computer, and I was upstairs in my house and showed up on the phone, and I immediately ran downstairs and I found my wife and she was sitting at the kitchen table. And I said, "Babe, I love you. I want to tell you what I saw. And I just want to make sure that everything is in the light." And my, was she gracious to me. And she felt so loved. I was so vulnerable, I felt so weak. And I have tried to maintain that. And I have never seen pornography on the internet. Never. And that's not a testament to me, because I was anything but a good man prior to the saving work of Jesus Christ. And you know what? We need accountability in our lives. We need to talk to people around us, and we need to be honest, and we need to be vulnerable, even when they don't know what to do with it. And if they don't, find somebody who does. There are many, many good men and women that will embrace us and hold us and love us in the midst of it. So be one that walks uprightly sexually. Power. This is one that you're going to need to go to the Lord and say, "God, you're going to have to teach me about this because I'm pretty clueless," because you probably won't. However, you know about manipulation. You recognize when you're feeling manipulated, when you're in touch with that. And so actually, you've got a grid for understanding some of this stuff. But Henry, now in strong influence in my life, said this: it's easier to control people than to love people. It's easier to play God than to be like God. And we must understand that we need to learn that spiritual authority is given to us in order to love and serve other people and to lift them up beyond where we are. And one of the great gifts that God has given me while being in the academy is that I came from years of being a leader in missions organization. I had no positional authority here. And it has taught me a lot about how important it is to learn to persuade and to love and serve. And those that rise in positions of authority and hierarchies need to recognize, we need to recognize it is how important it is to have a counterbalance of accountability. We need to have a counterbalance of accountability. Otherwise, we get into echo chambers. We need to watch out for that. Family. Many don't finish well because of marriage falls apart. By the way, you might notice that there's relationships between these barriers and obstacles. They like to go duos and triplets and to really wreak havoc. And so what that means is that first and foremost, my relationship with Christ is central. I'm transparent with Him, I'm honest with Him, I have a life with God, then my wife, then my children, then my extended family. Years ago, my parents shared, we were living overseas, life was really busy, and they said, "We're really hurt. We left. And we're sacrifices necessary to jump on a plane and fly halfway around the world to sit down together with them. You know, I broke my life up into decades, and I tried to think of things that I needed to repent for. And we worked through systematically my life, and they did the same. And it was really painful, but it was oh so glorious. And that may be these types of things may be necessary for you sometimes. Forgiveness. A little word about forgiveness. You've heard me rant about this. You've heard me weep talking about forgiveness. But forgiveness is an incredible gift for you. Forgiveness means that nobody can own you. Because you release them through forgiveness. Great, great power. There is little that I've seen in my life of ministry that cripples more than unforgiveness. You can even be physically sick. You can take my arms out of yours. But it can suffocate. Right. So, as I said to my good friend, one day, that for our ability to forgive may be the single litmus test that I would hold up to evaluate Christianity. How good of forgivers are. Jesus on the cross, looking down at those who are crucified. And what does he say? He says, forgive them. Pride. We're going to experience some tension with this. We need to have a healthy respect for ourselves while recognizing that we have nothing that wasn't given to us by God. Are we teachable? When we're challenged, are we able to hear and apply and really, really hear it? Our positions cannot be where we find our identity. Otherwise, you'll be deaf. You'll be deaf. So we need to be able to hear even from another sinner, as they always are. As Russ Gregg said, how do we find the kernel of truth in every criticism? And then plateauing, this is the last one. Plateauing is very simply when we get to a place as leaders where we're competent, we are really capable of what we do, and almost don't need God because we're kind of coast. This is the single greatest challenge that you will face. It's more likely, according to the studies that Dr. Clinton has done, it's more likely that you would succumb to this temptation than to sex or power. This echoes in my brain. I hear this one. And one of the best ways to fight plateauing is to read and to listen to people. And to find somebody who thinks something differently than you and listen to them. And then repeat back what they say and never give your opinion. Just go and just sail it. Okay. So be aware of the temptation to plateau. And then, five things quickly to enhance finishing well. And that is perspective, renewal, disciplines, learning, posture, and mentoring. Tell us a couple of short stories. Perspective, by the way, when we talk privately or in small groups and you ask me a question about life, my response is usually giving you perspective. Okay? So think back on those conversations. Okay? Perspective is identifying and acknowledging the great gift that a person is, you, and then also what a gift your future is. And then the provision of Christ links those two. The promises that he's made in your past and to you, the gifts that he's given you, and then the future calling that is yours together with him. And so when we talk, what I'm saying is, that's what I'm trying to connect for you and to give you a perspective of a lifetime of ministry. And so that's why you hear me say things like, you know, it's pretty normal what you're thinking right now and what you're feeling. Let me remind you of what lies ahead. I'm talk to you about your future. This is why Jesus is worth it. And this is the hope that is yours. And so as you get discouraged, it's because you're introspective, you lose sight of these things. And so you need times of getting perspective. Renewal is the spiritual renewal I'm talking about. Seeking the Lord, receiving from Him, being refreshed by Him. This is really, really important. People who finish well, fight for and pursue times of renewal in their spiritual lives. Do it. I have a friend at church, a good friend, David. And he texted me recently and said, hey, I want to go to this monastic and asking place, you know, and spend a few days with God and just be quiet and pray and hear from Him. And do you want to do it? I said, yes! Yes! Let's do it. And because I remember that is good for me, for those I love and serve, for me to be refreshed. Disciplines, there are certain key disciplines. This is a day and age where we kind of, our church traditions, many of them don't even talk about spiritual disciplines. It's lumped into legalism, it's not. I remember Mike Singletary, who's a great linebacker for the Chicago Bears. And Mike's a Christian man. Too slow, undersized, not strong enough, but is arguably the best at his position of all time. Right, he's one of those guys. And he worked harder than anybody, watched more film than anybody. He was more disciplined than anybody on the field. And people ask him, how did you become so great? And he said, well, I cultivated certain disciplines. And then when I was on the field, I played like a madman. So these things shaped him and enabled his reflexes to be incredibly enlightened. And spiritual disciplines do the same for you. I fast less than I used to, but I fast the internet now more. Okay? Because you have to adapt, you have to change. And so I do, I'm careful with what I watch, you know that. It's a temptation, and I'm more successful than sometimes than others. But cultivate disciplines, hear this. Okay? Disciplines are, they make you stronger. They make you stronger. And then a learning posture, maintain a learning posture. This is the number one guard against plateauing, for example. So this means be a reader and be a learner. And then mentoring. Go to people that have done this a little longer than you. And go up to them and say, hi, I see things in you that I'd like in my own life. Can I buy you lunch? And you know what? They'll probably say yes. And then you spend time with them. And you glean from them. And you learn from them. So can it be done? You've seen barriers you need to avoid. You see in the answers that you need to embrace. Can it be done? Yes, it can be done. Look at the life of Paul. He was the worst of sinners. He's even worse than you. If you can imagine that. Look at Daniel. Look at Joseph. It can be done. And most importantly, look at Christ. Here's the thing. Don't think of you live the Christian life for Christ. Think you live the Christian life through Him. Okay? I can't tell you how liberating it was when I realized that I didn't need to be full of great faith. Jesus died to give me His life. That means that His faith, His love, His courage, His goodness is mine. And so I say, Lord, I am faith. I have faith like a mustard seed. And He says, you're good. Here's mine. And He gives it to me. And I don't have enough love. And Jesus says, it's okay. I died to give you mine. And so it's possible because He did it. Do we believe the gospel? He did it. It's
mine. Goodness, what a gift. What a gift. So now listen carefully as I bring this to a close. It's clear in Daniel and Paul and Alea Wellman that character is central. Did you hear what she said about integrity? Did you hear? No secrets. Okay, listen, man, when I die and people go through my phone or my files or people start talking, I want them to say, you know what? There's no secrets. And I saw Jesus. So listen to a few of Paul's character challenges as I close. These are all for Timothy. Don't let anyone look down on you because you are young, class of 2021. That rhymes. But set an example for the believers in speech, in life, in love, in faith, and in purity. Set an example. I said to my wife once, I said, you know, I'm not comfortable saying, follow me as I follow Christ. And she stepped kind of close to me and got in my face, and she said, why? If you want, who will? Watch your life and your doctrine closely. Your life matters, your doctrine matters too. You need to learn to identify what it is and speak it, own it. Because if you do, you will save both yourself and your hearers. Flee the evil desires of youth. Think Joseph. Flee and pursue righteousness, faith, love, and peace, along with those who call on the Lord with a pure heart. So, class of 2021, I'm going to charge you right now. Okay? And so, I'm going to ask you to stand. Can you please stand? Members of the Hope Academy class of 2021, I charge you, finish well. Keep on pressing toward Christ and his character, still growing in your love for him and intimacy with him, still pressing on to make him known, still living as his disciple and loving the people God places in your life relentlessly, seeking to know and do God's will, fulfilling your God-given potential in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you.
Scholar Award. Evelyn Alea received our most prestigious award. It's the Hope Graduate Award. Please
given to the graduate who best exemplifies the home values of honor, optimism, perseverance, and excellence. The recipient is chosen by all the staff members of Hope Academy, and this year two students were chosen for that award, for that graduate award. So congratulations, Sophia, Evelyn, and Elena. And now it is time to confirm the diplomas. Graduates, when I call your name, I'm going to have you come forward to receive your diploma. So the first row of graduates, if you come and line up. Abel Berhanu Appal. Joshmar Arteaga Montez. Ariel Matanse. Theodore Robert Jorgen. Israel Salio Pacheco. Jalen Marcel Leaves. Christopher Yupongi Ishbi.
Students would space out because your families are going to come up and pray for you guys. So,
go to their pods.
Go to your pods. It's first year in pods. So, go to your family pod. You guys are going to spend some time in prayer with your family. So, families, please pray for your students. This is the last time you will pray for them while they are still technically a student at Hope Academy. So, it's been a long journey for many of them. And we will close in a few minutes with prayer. With you, Father, and it becomes more of their own every single day. So Father, we commit this time to you. We thank you for this glorious opportunity that we have a graduation together as a community at our school. So Father, we love you. We thank you. And your Son, his name is Yeshua, we pray. Amen. All right, give your students another hug.
in your ways as they behold the immeasurable worth of your glory. And all God's people said, Amen. Amen.